Hello everyone, I'm Kanish Shekhar and today I want to discuss with you section 124A of the IPC, the Indian Penal Code, which is also famously known as the sedition law. And this has been making a lot of news. Even today a person has been booked under this law. The Delhi Minority Commission Chairman Shah Zafrullah Islam Khan has been booked under this because he wrote something on his Facebook and it had mention of Jakir Naik, and he was leveling praise on it. 2 days later he apologized, but then the case has been registered. So without going into the merits of whether it was right or wrong, let us try to examine what the sedition law is, under what circumstances it came, what are the various provisions, and then finally we'll discuss whether this law should remain in India, in a mature civilized democracy, as we all take pride in it, or it should be done away with. So here we go. The background of the law is that it was drafted by Macaulay, by Lord Macaulay, who wrote IPC in 1870. Now IPC came 10-15 years before 1870, so this section 124A is a late addition. So what prompted Macaulay to introduce Section 124A of the sedition law? The answer is there were many mutinies going on in India. Not only the 1857 revolt, there were many small mutinies happening at many places in India, and one such was Wahhabi movement. Now to stop or to confront the Wahhabis, this particular act was particularly to confront the Wahhabis, this act was introduced. So now Wahhabis also become important for you. See, Section 124A is making a lot of news. So under what circumstances it came? The answer is related with Wahhabis. So please read about Wahhabis, read about Sayyid Ahmad Shah Walirullah and Abdul Wahhab. You will come across these things in your modern India. So I'm not going to go into all that. Let us confine ourselves to the legal aspect of the law. So what happens is, that when you are booked under sedition, so what does the law actually say? This is what is written in the Bare Act of the IPC. Now, slightly complicated language. Let me just make it simple for you. Anything, any act of expression, anything that you express. Now, when I say expression, it can be your writings, it can be your words. You can make a speech. You can write a poetry, a shayari, and even without writing or without speaking, you can convey, you can express, like you can act. It can be mono acting, it can be a symbolic gesture. So if any of them, expression is more than writing and speaking. It can be a song, it can be a painting. People have been booked for making cartoons. People have been booked for shero shayari and poetry. So anything which government finds to be against the government, which is established by law. Now, government of India or any state government is a government established by law. Then that can be punished under this very provision. Now, what the punishment is, that it is a non-bailable offense, so you won't be getting bail for it. And it can vary from imprisonment up to 3 years to a life term, along with a fine. That depends upon the intensity of the crime that has been done. And person booked under this law not apply for a government job, and they have to live without their passport and must present themselves in court as and when required. So we see some very strict provisions. That is why this law is very contested upon. Now how it has evolved all over the years. So even when it was operative, Bal Gangadhar Tilak was the first person who was booked under this law, and he was jailed for 6 years. Later on, Gandhiji was booked. Both these people were booked by the English. Gandhiji was booked under this, and this is what he had to say. The prince among the political sections of the IPC designed to suppress the liberty of citizens. So Gandhiji was clear that this law has been drafted by the English to be used against the Indians to curb their freedom, to limit their liberty. Now, a committee was formed in the Constituent Assembly, which was formed to make the Constitution of India. The Indian Constitution was given by the Constituent Assembly. So there were many committees in it. And the Committee on Fundamental Rights was headed by or chaired by Sardar Patel. So this thought, the committee thought, and Sardar Patel also thought, that should we include sedition? You must be knowing this. If you don't know this, let me just brief this to all of you, that none of our fundamental rights are absolute. All of them are qualified because there are reasonable restrictions on each and every fundamental right that is guaranteed by Part 3 of the Indian Constitution to all its citizens. So can sedition be such a reasonable restriction? So after much contemplation, it was thought upon that let us wish this away. Let sedition not be a component of reasonable restriction. Now Article 19 Clause 2 imposes reasonable restriction. So there are eight grounds on which reasonable restrictions can be imposed, like sovereignty. If anything that is acting as a threat to sovereignty and integrity of India, security of the state, public order, decency, morality, so on and so forth, there are eight such things that can be classified as reasonable restriction, but not sedition. Later on, what happened? There was this famous case, Kedarnath Singh versus State of Bihar in 1962, where the Supreme Court said that they tried to examine the constitutional validity of the sedition law, that is Section 124A of the IPC. Supreme Court came to this conclusion that this law is constitutionally apt, it is constitutionally valid, but then freedom of speech and expression are also very important. So this freedom of speech and expression should not be used to incite violence, which means if you use or rather misuse your speech and expression freedom, your freedom to speech and expression, to incite violence, to engage into vandalism, then you can be booked under the sedition law. That was the position under this very case way back in 1962. From there, like I said, that inciting violence would be detrimental, adversely detrimental to public order. And public order is among those eight conditions on which reasonable restrictions can be imposed under Article 19 Clause 2. So Article 19 Clause 2 was amended, that undermining the security of state, this very phrase was replaced with in the interest of public order. So again, if you do anything that jeopardizes public order, you can be booked under Section 124 Clause A. Next, what happened was, there was this Balwant Singh case in 1995. There was this Khalistan movement going on, and the Prime Minister of India, Mrs. Gandhi, was killed by Khalistani terrorists. And certain people from Punjab believed in a separate, they called for a separate nation, that is Khalistan. And it was a call to break India. They wanted to have a new country called Khalistan. So there were many slogans being raised. Babbar Khalsa Panth, something like that. So again, this case came to Supreme Court, that raising pro-Khalistan slogans, will it amount to sedition? Supreme Court said no, only raising slogans will not apply, it's not a valid ground for imposing sedition law or arresting anyone under such law. But if there's a call for armed rebellion under the state, if you say that we want Khalistan or we want some other istan, and you start engaging in violence, or if someone listens to you and starts engaging in the violence, then that would be an apt condition for sedition. That was the established decision of Supreme Court in this Balwant Singh case in 1995. Now, recent one is the Shreya Singh versus Union of India case in 2015, where Supreme Court has said that any words or ideology can be propagated in India, even if it is against the prevailing democratic wisdom. Democratic order of the country. There are many ideologies or many, for example, Maoism. Now, Maoists do not believe in democratic procedure. They called for an armed struggle. So you can well propagate this to people who are willing to listen to you. But then, violence should not be there. So you can say that Maoism or communism or any other ism should replace democracy in India. That is all fine. There was this famous case of Vinayak Sen. I am reminded of Vinayak Sen is a doctor who was arrested by Chhattisgarh police some 10-15 years back, and for his alleged Maoist links. And it was said by the police that he is harboring hardcore Naxalites in his clinic, and he refuses to treat the people from police, and he treats Naxals, and there are meetings which he facilitates, he provides ideological support. and Supreme Court let him free. Supreme Court said that, see, that can be done because you believe in Maoist ideology, you can propagate that. But if you engage in violence, so we need to prove whether a particular person has engaged into violence or not. That will be a fit case for sedition. Now, moving ahead with that, this question went to the Law Commission. Law Commission is under the Government of India. And in 2018, this is what the Law Commission had to say, because there were cases, there were protests against the government, and people were slapped with Section 124A. People from Assam, people in Delhi, so many people. So this is what the Law Commission said, that in a democracy, singing from the same songbook is not a benchmark of patriotism. People should be at liberty to show their affection towards their country in their own way. For doing the same, one might indulge in constructive criticism or debate. Now, again, constructive criticism is a very ambiguous word. So what is constructive or what is destructive criticism? That is for courts to decide at the moment. I guess the violence part will play a detrimental role. If you are just opposing it ideologically, if you are suggesting a policy alternative, that's fine. But violence would be destructive criticism. So this is what the Law Commission has said on the sedition law in 2018. And it should be invoked in cases. This is what we all should agree on, where the intention behind any act is to disrupt public order or to overthrow the government with violence and illegal means. See, we have an elected government in India and everywhere in the states of India. You may support or not support the government. You can, of course, criticize the government. That is your democratic right. But when you say that they should be replaced through violence or there should be an armed rebellion against the government, that is a fit case for Section 124, Clause A. So some section of people believe that this law should be done away with. It's a colonial relic. It's an archaic law. But then so many laws are archaic law. The Contract Act is archaic. So many laws, we are operating on the same laws that have been given. The Police Act is archaic of 1861. The idea is to see whether that those laws fit into the current context. And time and again, here we have examined several case laws, which says that sedition law should not be scrapped. But then if anyone calls for violence, that is the litmus test. If there's a call to violence or an armed rebellion, then it's a fit condition for sedition law, not otherwise. Law Commission also said that people out of frustration sometimes say something like crime against women. And if someone says that India is not a country for women, no country for women, no country for minorities. So that can be said by an individual. This is exactly what the Law Commission said. That can be these things, such things can be said in a fit of rage, in frustration, in anger. So don't book them under sedition law until they do not incite violence or advocate violence against the state. So every irresponsible exercise of right to free speech and expression cannot be termed seditious. Like I said, in a fit of anger, someone can say that India is discriminating, the government is discriminating. Don't do that. Don't book them for sedition. A mature democracy needs to act in a mature way. So a question here, how to strike a balance between Section 124A and right to freedom of speech and expression. If you attempt this question, then please start with the background into which Section 124A came, when it was brought, by whom it was brought, and what does freedom of speech and expression imply in India. And then there are reasonable restrictions on the same, and then the litmus test is where you will conclude your question on. That please use it against those who, as given by the Supreme Court in its several judgments, you can quote these judgments and sum it up in a line, that don't book people just for dissenting or for saying things out of frustration. But then if they call violence, if they engage into acts of vandalism, then there can be case about it. So this is what I had to discuss today. Hope you understood. We'll keep meeting each other. Bye for now.